Hello viewers and welcome to a brand new Let's Play series. I'm your host Pew Pew Choo Choo once again, and we are taking a break from Rome Total War 2 to play in a different era with the same game series. As you can see, we're playing Napoleon Total War and we're going to be playing this game as France. So I find this is actually my favorite Total War game out of the few around. We're playing it with the Epic Edition of Darthmod, so we're going to get some truly epic battles. And this is a mixture of, this modification for Napoleon Total War is a mixture of balancing, graphics, and the thing that I like most about it is that it comes with these pre-made save, hacked save games that allow you to play the campaign with 40 unit stacks. So to give you an idea of that, I mean, in Rome Total War 2 you had a 20 unit stack and the units were 160 men each at the very most. Inside this, the squad sizes could be like over 500, and you can have like, well, obviously 40 unit cards filled with those. So yeah, you get some truly epic battles. You know, I find this time period particularly interesting, and with that kind of said, I'll be going over the time period a lot inside these early episodes. One thing that I really didn't like about, one thing that I was starting to get tired of Rome Total War 2 was the fact that, you know, I really didn't have very much to say about the time period anymore. So what I'm going to be doing here is that France inside the early game, or rather inside this game, is led by this man right here, Napoleon Bonaparte. We're going to be, we'll talk about him a lot as time goes along throughout the Let's Play here, but for the first few turns in any Total War game, we won't be seeing all too much action. The people at Creative Assembly, the people who make these games, kind of alleviated that problem with Rome Total War 2, but inside this game, the first few turns are fairly slow. The good thing about this mod is that it speeds it up simply because you get a lot more income right off the bat. You start off with a lot of income, so hopefully, what I'll be able to do inside these first few episodes is that I'll be able to talk a lot about the historical background for this game, and as we continue to push forward here, I'll be able to build up our economy, build ourselves an army, and move forward from there. So currently what I'm doing here is that, unlike Rome Total War 2, how the provinces works is that you have one town representing one region, and the towns will always have the names listed right here. On the map you have the little town, and you also have their ports and the little farms and stuff, and what I'm doing is that I just want to build up upon my economy, so that's what we've done right here. Currently, we are at war with Austrians, and I'm going to shift Napoleon down to Italy, where then we will assemble an army and move forwards from there, and really go from there. But to really enjoy the game fully, I mean, to really enjoy the time period fully, one of the things that we do have to just kind of start off on is the French Revolution. Napoleon Bonaparte rose through the ranks, really, by starting off as a humble artillery officer, and I believe he was Corsican, so he came from a little island right here. At a very young age, he joined up with the French army. He was originally an artillery man, so he was in an artillery regiment, you know. And he fought with them for quite a long time. He fought in Italy, he fought in Austria, he even fought in Egypt and Spain, well, Spain was later on, but he did fight in quite a lot of different portions of the world before heading back, getting crowned Emperor of France, and then I think before that he even got the title of King of Italy. So yeah, there's a lot of stuff happening there. Where is Napoleon?
Use spies to damage enemy buildings through acts of sabotage.
This advisor needs to be quiet. So currently what we're going to do is that we're going to shift around some of our units and we're going to get Napoleon there. One thing that we should note with this modification is that you actually gain a lot of different units to choose from as opposed to the original game. You do have some flavor units like French conscripts, and you have the French reunion battalion, the different regiments. So yeah, this mod really does add a lot. You can also have these Portuguese legionnaires here as well. And the other thing is that you can get these massive unit queues. So as you can see here inside Paris, we can build a whopping like 7 units at one time. I mean, I think the whole journey of Napoleon really, really started out inside. The catalyst to it was the French Revolution. So before all of this, you know, currently it's the year 1805. Before this, what had happened inside the world was the American Revolution, which we all know was the Americans fighting the British for independence, really. So one of the big backers of America was the French. Actually, there was that rivalry between the French and the British. So going off of that, the French government actually went into huge amounts of debt, supporting this revolution inside the Americas. And well, we know how that turned out. France was France went to debt, America was formed, the British were pushed out and into Canada, and that was kind of the end of that. But it technically wasn't, because you know, there was that debit, and that debit transformed into dissent, and from dissent sprung out Napoleon, in a sense. So at the time, I mean, or rather after the American Revolution, France was in debit, but the upper classes weren't really in debit, so to say. And what I mean by that was that it really didn't affect the upper classes at all. You had the king, which was this huge rotund guy, and he wore like really, really fancy clothes, and obviously it didn't really affect him at all. The churchmen, the clergy, you know, so your bishops and your higher ranked priests and all that, they didn't pay taxes, so there was really no burden to them. And to the aristocrats, the nobility of France, I mean, the actual, you know, taxes weren't too bad. I mean, when compared to the amount of debit France was in. So where did all of that get, where did all of that debit and all of that stuff go? Well, it went to the ordinary men. France had a system of, it was called the General Assembly, and it split the population into three different groups. You had the first estate, which is the aristocrats, the nobility. The second estate was which was the clergy. And then the third estate was everybody else. And well, guess who got the short end of the stick, right? So while on one hand, I mean, the nobility continued their lives as usual, the ordinary men were overburdened with taxation and just in general. We actually have some holdings inside Hanover that I didn't notice. And yeah, the ordinary man was just kind of, you know, just kind of screwed out of his money, really. So that caused a lot of dissent in France at the time. And the other thing was that inside France at the time, it was an authoritarian regime, so the people there weren't necessarily too friendly. So with that kind of said, the ordinary man had a great deal of resentment for the privileged, for the nobility, really. So as time kind of went on, is this a trade fleet right here? This does not seem to be a trade fleet. So as time kind of went on, I mean, this dissent eventually brewed, and it eventually started to become talk of, you know, revolt and revolution, and really going from there, the idea, you know, the cry for liberty really came up. One of the famous, or rather the landmark things that happened was the storming of the Bastille Fortress, where the French population stormed the fortress of Bastille, which was I think slightly outside of Paris, somewhere right around there, and they were really searching for two things, I believe. They wanted to free the prisoners locked up inside there, although that was kind of a secondary thing. The main thing was that it was an armory too, so they wanted to stockpile themselves with guns. The first thing they didn't really accomplish. They didn't really find any prisoners there, although there were a few. But I do believe they got the second thing, which was weaponry. So that led to a little bit of panic with the upper classes. You know, they were starting to lose control of the general population. Obviously, with so many nobility men, with only so many nobility men, they couldn't really control a very, very large, angry mob of regular people. No matter how many guards they had, really, they'd always get overwhelmed. So, really, going from there, I should probably buy some defenses inside Hanover. So really going from there, the king called for what was called for the General Assembly. The assembly was, in theory, an elective group of people composed of the first and second and third estate, who would vote on important issues and, you know, resolve them as a form of diplomacy or democracy, right? But the issue with it was that inside that system, the votes were separated into the three estates. So with that kind of said, I'm pretty sure a lot of you guys are seeing the problem with it right now, is that if you separate it into three different groups, you have three votes on one issue, which in theory would settle most problems, right? I mean, it's an odd number of votes. Either way, everyone has to vote, so problems would be solved. But then again, if you think about it, you have two votes that essentially go to the same people, the upper class. So with that kind of said, no matter what, the third estate didn't really matter in that, so long as the clergy and the aristocrats held together, it was a show trial of sorts in that it didn't really matter. So what had happened was that through a series of events, I mean, you had the tennis court oath, which was the third estate forming their own assembly and stuff like that, and a lot of rioting and killing and of just like nobility and especially tax collectors in general. Over time, what had happened was that new and more temporary governments were formed. So during that time period, I mean, France was definitely very, very unstable. You know, you had on one side huge amounts of debit being formed, and inside the country you had this rebellion, right? So what had happened was that governments were just kind of constantly being replaced by other governments as time kind of went by. I mean, I think you had the Directory, and then you had the Consulate, and Napoleon at the time, over the course of his early career, he gained fame as a commander of sorts. He gained popularity with the army men and people like that. And when the Consulate took over control of France from whatever other revolutionary group which was in power at the time, Napoleon actually managed to host a coup d'état, which is a government overthrow, which is I think that's the translation for it. But it was a revolution. It overthrew the government and put new people in charge. More importantly, and put Napoleon as the first Consulate, so he had the majority of the power. So going from there, what had happened was that after about 5 years or so inside that position, there was a referendum inside the country, and a referendum is essentially a direct vote. So instead of voting, say, like nowadays, we vote for a senator and a representative, and they cast their votes in favor of an issue for us. A referendum was a direct type. Oh no, gonna surrender that battle. Forgot about that. So yeah, a referendum was called, and because of the popularity of Napoleon at the time, he was actually declared Emperor of France. Now, I'm not sure how he got his other title, which is the King of Italy, but that also happened too. So with that kind of said, that puts us really at the start of Napoleon's legacy. And he did a lot of things. He was, first and foremost, he was a great general. He modernized, he didn't really modernize it, compared to nowadays, obviously, but at the time he modernized military thinking. He modernized the legislative portions of France with the Napoleonic Code and all that, and he was also a great diplomatic person. The problem with him was that he was at times incredibly, I would say narcissistic. He was he had this sense that he was destined for glory of sorts. But anyhow, looks like we're at the point inside the game where we can begin military conquest, so I think we'll do that. So let's begin by fighting one battle onto the field, so then I can show you guys the fights inside this game. And yeah, that really led up to this point. 1805 was the start of Napoleon Bonaparte's campaigns, and his campaigns lasted up until 1815, where he lost the Battle of Waterloo. And there's actually a movie about the Battle of Waterloo. If you search it up into YouTube, you'll be able to find it. But I don't know the actress's name in it, and I think it's a really great movie. So yeah, that's kind of the summary of kind of where we really start off the game with. And going from here, I mean, we can make our own history, but what I think happened was that Napoleon first beat Austria, then he beat Prussia, and finally he went into Spain, conquered Spain, although Spain was always a problem. But eventually what things had led up to was the war in Russia, and from there things started to go downhill. So we're starting we're start we're yeah we're starting the battle now. Coming back to this game, I find that the textures inside Rome Total War 2 aren't even the graphics inside this game is superbly done compared to the other lines of games. And as you can see, the lines of troops are nearly endless. Our standard troops are these 360 groups of people. We have some light infantry, which are 240 units worth. And the good thing about the Darth mod is that it gives you a lot of flavor units. And the thing that I like the most about it is that you get these French conscripts, which you can just throw at people, and they'll typically, yeah, you'll typically they'll typically run out of ammunition before they run out of bodies, so you can just hammer them away at enemy lines. What I'm doing here is that I need to structure our army so that we can get our guys set up here. These guys should just assemble just like that. We'll make our army into a nice little pile because I have no other form that I want to go with, and we will just get this blob to move forward like such. Yeah, definitely a ton of men onto battlefield. So we'll move this army up to the road, and we'll start to pound the enemy with our guns, and we'll start to move forward like that. Now, speaking of our troops, I do believe this game does give you the stats for the men, but it does it in a slightly different way than Rome Total War 2. So over here, let's actually check out what the Austrian Empire has, seeing as how we're going to be fighting these guys a lot. So yeah, they typically have infantry, but they also have some specialty infantry just like us. They have the Archduke Charles Legion Garrison right here. So this is their elite men, and this is from the looks of it, their center of their line. They actually have a lot of these guys. They also have some armed citizenry, so peasantry, and some fusiliers, which are their normal soldiers. And our ranks, we have a nice mixture of different units that we can use. First and foremost, you start off the game with these 6-pounder cannons, and they're not particularly strong, but I mean they do the job. Cannery these days were definitely like the weapon of choice for commanders. Napoleon was kind of known for his tactic of concentrating artillery fire. Inside these games, you can see here that we have like 8 artillery cannons per unit. In reality, I mean, a formation of cannonry would be like 12 to 28 guns, and these battles would be, well, a battle would essentially cons would be fights between like 70,000 men at times, so 40,000 men at times, and the cannonry was really, really massed up. And yeah, just no game apparently simulates this correctly, but they had a lot of cannonry at the time. So with all of this cannonry, what Napoleon really was known to do was that he would get all of his guns, or at least a vast majority of them, focus on the enemy's weak points, and just hurl barrages and barrages and barrages into them until the weak points in the enemy's lines broke. And then, obviously, with that said, one of their flanks, a gap would be formed inside their lines, and the infantry can then exploit that. So yeah, that was one thing that he was known for. Fortunately, unfortunately, we can't really simulate the massed barrages very, very well inside this game, just simply because I don't know why. Maybe it's just a game design decision, or maybe because artillery wouldn't be fun if battles just kind of consisted of shooting back and forth with big guns. I don't know. I would enjoy it.